Test, 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 test. Test, test, test.
reason why Lammy is here on the floor? Is there a reason why Lammy is here on the floor?
This is like Abby's stuff. She usually sits over here. Awesome. Whose music is this? Abigail's.
Turn on mic. Check one, two, check.
I Good morning. Welcome to this hybrid format service at Woodland Park Presbyterian Church on this Pentecost Sunday. I am Pastor Joe Sheeran, and if this is your first time or first time in a long time joining us for worship here in the sanctuary on Facebook or Zoom, we're glad you're here. We hope you feel welcome. We hope you feel comfortable to participate in as much or as little of the service as feels right to you. Along those lines, we will be celebrating communion later today, as we do every Sunday here at Woodland Park Presbyterian Church. If you are joining us remotely, this is your reminder, your invitation to have something ready to eat and drink for that part of the service, something that feels right to you. Before we continue in our time of worship, I'd like to share one quick announcement that is important to this community. I'd like to acknowledge that Woodland Park Presbyterian Church and many of our homes are located on the unceded ancestral lands of the Duwamish people. We acknowledge that they are still here, continuing to honor and bring light to their heritage, and we benefit every day from the theft of their land. May that acknowledgement and commitment trouble us into action yet undiscerned. As we continue in worship, one of our traditions born out of this time of pandemic that we are slowly making our way out of is exchanging peace using the ASL for peace be with you. And that looks like peace be with you. So peace be with you. So there's a sort of a flip, and then your hands fall. Friends, the peace of Christ be with you all. Let's exchange signs of peace.
Peace to all in the sanctuary. Peace be with you, Salva.
Peace be with you, Salva.
Peace be with you, Judy.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you, Judy and Lynn.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
Steve, Mimi, peace be with you. WPPC, peace be with you. Robert, are you in Michigan today? I was going to say I'm right next door in Wisconsin.
Are you? Okay. Where?
Visiting my son here in Madison.
Oh, nice. Well, just across the lake. Just a quick jaunt.
Okay. Please join me in the call to worship. God, Holy Spirit, come to us. Come among us. Come as the wind and cleanse. God, Holy Spirit, come to us. Come to us. Come as the fire and burn. God, Holy Spirit, Come to us, come to us. Come as the dew and refresh. God, Holy Spirit, come to us, come to us. Convict, convert, and consecrate many hearts and lives to our great good and to your greater glory. Please join me in the prayer of confession. Generous God, you give us the gift of your Spirit, but we confess that we have not known how to use it. You send us the Spirit of courage, but we have been afraid. You send us the Spirit of truth, but we cling to our illusions. You send us of our hurts. Holy Spirit of forgiveness, come to us again. Shake our hearts, set our souls on fire with your love. Send us out into the world rejoicing in your power. We hold out to you all our particular burdens of guilt and sin, and we ask for your help to live the way of your justice and love. Amen.
Friends, hear the good news. The God who created this world with a word is not finished speaking. The Christ who lived among us to redeem this world is still alive, and the Spirit who moved among and in the people of God is still moving. We are God's beloved. Enclaimed in love,
we begin again.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Spirit of the living God, as we hear these ancient words that you moved our forebears to write, fall afresh upon us, open our hearts, and renew our spirits to be your people. Amen. From Acts 2:1-4. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as of fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were enticed and led astray to idols that could not speak. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking by the Spirit of God ever says, "Let Jesus be cursed." And no one can say, "Jesus is Lord," except by the Holy Spirit. Now, there are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of services, but the same Lord, and there are a varieties of activities.
But it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone.
To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good.
To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom,
and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit,
to another faith by the same Spirit,
to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit,
to another the working of miracles,
to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits,
to another various kinds of tongues,
to another, the interpretation of tongues.
All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually just as the Spirit chooses. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free. We are all made to drink of one Spirit. The stories of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
inspire for that magnificent proclamation of this story.
I'm not on. Talk about the Spirit. Thank you, Todd. It's a very helpful sign. This sign says, turn on mic. I want to pause and thank Jay Kyle and our choir for that excellent and moving and very effectively illustrative proclamation of the story today. And I hope that all of you will pray with me. Living God, we pray that your Spirit would move, that your breath would flow through us, that it would cause our chests to rise and fall, that your Spirit would animate our lives, our hearts, and our minds, that our thoughts would honor you, our words would proclaim you, and our actions would be as your hands and feet moving through the world. May it be so. Amen. We interrupt the story every year on Pentecost in this narrative lectionary. We move past the post-resurrection sort of chaos and into the lives and words and deeds of the apostles. But on Pentecost, we interrupt our story to come back to this moment. Some of you may recall a few weeks ago we considered the moment that Jesus ascended into heaven, as told in Acts. This is 7 days after that. And if you're wondering about the math, you're wondering, where is he coming from this? It's 50 days from Passover to Shavuot, which is the day on which we now call Pentecost. So on the third day after Passover, on the first day after Passover, Jesus died. On the third day, he rose. And scripture tells us he was with the disciples for 40 days. So that gets us to 43. So 43 and 50 gets you 7. So 1 week later. And we don't know if they have been gathered in one place. Acts 1 tells us they stayed there in prayer and meditation, gathered as a whole community. Now, we've just been through lockdown the last few years. So perhaps 7 days in one place gathered with one community doesn't seem quite so daunting as it might have. But I suspect that they dispersed and came back together. Shavuot is a pilgrimage holiday, a day where Jews and Jewish obedient acolytes, those who were devoted to God despite not being Jewish, would have gathered in Jerusalem. This day has agricultural roots, but it is in the story that the people tell, the day on which they received the Ten Commandments. On Passover, they are delivered from Egypt and rush into the wilderness. On Shavuot, you receive the law, God's guidance for how you are to live. And so it is in the Christian story, on Passover and on Easter, we receive this revelation of God's love and God's reconciliation. And on Pentecost, we receive God's continued presence in the Spirit to guide our lives. Now, we say a lot of different things about the Spirit, but one thing that we could say more of is the Spirit's power for animation. Now, that word animation, we think of cartoons, right? Cartoons that become alive by how they are arranged together, figures that are two-dimensional, that come on, somehow take on a quality of life. But the root of the word is the Latin for spirit. If something is animated, it is inspirited. And in the act of creation, God breathed into the clay person, the earth creature, and creates human beings. On Pentecost, whether it's in Acts telling, which is Luke Acts, or in John's telling, which involves Jesus breathing on the disciples, God's breath re-enters into us, a kind of second creation. And so we sing, Spirit of the living God, by which we mean both Holy Ghost and also God's breath, breath of God, fall afresh on me. When I was a child, I was especially struck by this meditative hymn. When my church would sing it, I would listen for the Spirit to move. I would wish, I would pray fervently for it to fall afresh upon me. I was 8 years old, but I wanted it to be fresh. What would it be like? When have you felt the Spirit falling fresh upon you? Does it melt you? Does it mold you? Does it use you in a way that is fundamentally aligned with who you are and who you are created to be? How does it feel when that is happening? When you have found a moment where your life and the life of the universe are sharply aligned. Perhaps you found this up in a tree, encountering the wilderness and the majesty of the universe and the importance of preservation of life and beauty in the midst of our city. Perhaps you found this caring for children, teaching them the story and watching them sing and dance as they learn and reflect on how it is to be part of this tradition that we've inherited, and striving to leave them a tradition that wouldn't wound them, but would inspire curiosity and love. Perhaps you find this spirit when you're out working in community, listening to the stories of people who have been wounded by the world, and listening deeply for ways that you can touch their self-interest, touch your self-interest, and assemble a community for justice. When I was a child, I dreamed of that spirit falling afresh upon me so that I could do something that looks a lot like this. I was not a very imaginative child. I imagined that the spirit falling afresh on people would mean that we would learn to speak in ways that people could understand and connect, much like those first disciples on that day of Shavuot, where they suddenly find themselves able to communicate to a Jewish diaspora assembled from across the globe, where the boundaries of culture and the divisions of daily life, language, have started to separate a people who remain yet united by tradition. Perhaps I imagine that it would be an undoing of Babel. You all remember the Tower of Babel. We don't teach that story very often in the narrative lectionary. It's not part of the rotation. But the idea that the people were united, able to tell stories and able to motivate each other, and they built a tower that reached up to God, and that didn't work. And so they were separated. And from that division, culture, language, difference rose up. I find it rich that on this day, the story we tell is not of those differences being erased, but of those differences becoming part of the material of unity. It is not that we are, as Paul says, no longer Jew or Greek, slave or free, but that in our diversity, we find a unity that stretches across those boundaries. It is not that some of us are no longer Scottish or German or Washingtonian, but that these unities contain the diversity rather than subvert it. I imagine the spirit would fall in a way that would move us to do big things, big picture change, shouting for justice and liberation, shouting for peace and wholeness, preaching sermons. But I reflect on that 8-year-old boy listening to Spirit of the Living God, and I think about who else was singing in that room. I think about my mother, with whom these days I struggle to talk sometimes. We have very different views on the world, but my mother had gifts, and she has them still. Gifts for making children feel seen and heard and cared, gifts of energizing and teaching with creativity and imagination, gifts of recruiting people. Kathy's very good at twisting arms. Gifts of meeting people and listening to them, making them feel welcome and included. I think of my mother's gifts. I think of my father's gifts. David is very no-nonsense. He's charming and he'll meet you, and he'll listen to your story too. But what he's most worried about is getting straight down to business, and are the things that yet to be done, getting them done. David served on the Building and Grounds Committee and on the Finance Committee, and if there was a problem, he was liable to just show up on a Saturday and do it himself. His gift was not always inviting and including other people to share in the work, but he labored with a heart for his community, a heart for making sure that things were handled, that the grounds were safe and clean, that the garden was well-maintained and attractive, and that the kids had safe equipment to play on. I think of my father's gifts. I think of my sister's gifts. They were younger than me, and not quite so engaged by Bible study class as I was, but they had gifts too. Gifts for friendship, relationship. Gifts for drawing people in and making them feel welcome. Gifts for making peace. Today, my sister is the fulcrum upon which our family turns, and that's not just because she's the one with kids. If there's conflict, Laura is the one who's able to listen to everyone, make them feel heard, create a place where they can gather together and be, even though there's frustration. Those are Laura's gifts. I think of my other sister's gifts. Elizabeth, she was the youngest one. When Lizzie showed up at church, she brought energy and smile the way that a toddler and a young child can bring. But she also needed things. She needed care, attention. She challenged adults caring for her to be imaginative, to play. And the truth is, that's a gift also. Because the gifts that we have are not just for accomplishing things, they're for changing and being together. When one of us has need, when one of us is vulnerable, when one of us needs support and care, that too is a blessing. How are we changed by listening to and attending to the stories of each other? How are we changed by changing kitty litter or by helping folks get to the doctor? When one of us has need and is able to be vulnerable in asking for help and able to be gracious in thanking and blessing those who reach out to help, they provide a blessing to their community. That is an important and worthy contribution. I think about the gifts of all of my church family that raised me and formed me. Not because all of them had the full body of knowledge, all of the gifts, not because anyone was capable in every regard, but because all of them were gathered as a whole. Understanding that not everything was for each of them, but that all of it was for all of them together. On this Pentecost Sunday, if you are waiting for the Spirit of the living God to fall afresh upon you, I invite you to consider the ways that you are already in relationship. The words, the languages that you already speak, whether they be Spanish or French, or languages of different understandings, languages to talk to people who are angry or hurting, languages to talk to people who are feeling stuck, languages to hear from our neighbors what their concerns, what their strengths, what they're worried about, and where they're excited. I think about our Property with Purpose team, our Stewardship Committee, our Spiritual Formation Committee, which tried new things this weekend. I think about all of you. And so I pray that the Spirit of the living God fall afresh upon you this Sunday as on every day. May you be melted, molded. May you find your true purpose in God's creation. Amen. as a community of faith, as a congregation, as part of the body of Christ, we gather together to worship, to be together in fellowship and prayer. And so as part of our worship together, we share what is on our hearts, where our hearts are breaking, where our hearts are elated, for ourselves, our loved ones, our neighbors, our world. Friends, what prayers are there here in this room today of sorrow and concern?
Continued prayers for Len and Judy as they are going through some, you know, tough times, and they need a lot of our prayers, especially this week.
See, I have two. The first one is I want continued prayers for a couple of my neighbors, Bonnie and Pam, just having a lot of medical problems and don't seem to be going, they seem to be going kind of downhill. So prayers for them. And then a prayer for Neil's niece, Mel, who has just recently had a biopsy that doesn't look very good. So prayers for Neil and his whole family. Well, Melanie and her whole family.
For Bonnie and Pam, I pray. For Moni and her family, I pray. Other prayers.
My aunt Irene, that I told you about a week or so ago, she had a severe stroke on May 3rd, and she died on Wednesday, the 15th. So, and her service is next Thursday, but she's in Augusta, Kansas. So prayers for her family back there, that they will find grace and love and good memories.
For Irene, who has claimed the promise of the resurrection, and for her family, who are wrestling with, I imagine, a lot of emotions and grief while trying to hold together a family gathering in her memory, I pray. Other prayers.
Prayers for Chris Franklin, who is halfway through his cancer treatment, and he's staying healthy and enduring it. And also for Chris Adams, a family friend who's also being treated for cancer, a pretty severe, aggressive cancer. So prayers for Chris's.
For Chris Franklin and Chris Adams and their respective struggles with cancer, I pray. Other prayers?
I would pray for peace in the world. We're fighting in Ukraine. We're fighting in Gaza. We're fighting all over. To coin the phrase from the young man in Los Angeles during the racial riots down there, he said, "Can't we all just get along?" And that's my sentiment.
For peace in the many parts of this world where there is violence and oppression and struggle, I pray.
I also have prayer for all the stuff that's going on.
for a solution to our struggles that brings us together in peace and wholeness, I pray.
I was recently helping a student from Russia who was writing a paper with a new definition, and her definition she was writing had to do with the meaning of opposition in Russia, which she was saying was basically impossible at this point as the society changed. This was echoed in a series being published in the Washington Post, which is talking about the transformation of a country where it is no longer possible to have any form of protest or opposition, and a return to a nearly Stalinist type society. And I pray for them. They're mourning the death of the democracy that they had experienced since the fall of the Soviet Union, which now seems to have ended.
For our siblings in Russia, that they might have peace and justice, I pray.
Actually, and talk with it closer. How's that? It wasn't too many years ago when we would hear news reports about, when the global average temperature raises this far, then we'll start really having a problem. It's been 11 straight months of global highest temperature ever. There's huge swings in temperatures now. So the catastrophe that follows climate change is upon us, and it's going to start affecting islands of people that are at zero elevation first, and then it's just going to start. And so I pray for all of those people initially affected by it and fighting loudly to raise awareness.
For the increasing pace and severity of climate change, and for those vulnerable in harsh climates and low elevation that will be struggling in years to come, I pray. Other prayers. Let's continue in prayer. Holy One, send your Spirit. Living God, please send your Spirit to fall afresh upon this earth, to fall afresh upon all of us here. Send your Spirit to bring peace, wholeness to those who need it. God, for those vulnerable in our midst, out here on our streets, in inadequate housing, those who are suffering from loneliness or mental health challenges, addiction, we pray. God, we pray for those who are in our lives with challenges bearing down on them, those that we lift up in prayer and those that we can't find words for. God, for those in our midst who are struggling for wholeness, we pray. God, for the yearning in our hearts for home, for peace,
For shalom, we pray. And God, for those in our world who are enduring violence, deprivation, starvation, bombardment, those who live in countries and in places that don't know peace, but only war and threat and danger, we pray. And for those with power to change all of that, for those with voice and authority who bring that danger, who bring that threat, or who might have powers for peace, but refrain themselves, restrain themselves in fear out of prudence or greed. God, we pray that your spirit would move there also, that you would soften their hearts, that you would raise new hands and feet to bring about your justice and your peace everywhere in this world, in big ways and small ways. Holy One, hear our prayer and send your spirit. Send your spirit to renew the face of the earth and renew our hearts. Send your spirit to help us to remember to celebrate and to find joy in things unexpected. Holy One, we thank you we are not a far off God, but a God who is here in our midst, a God who took on human form, and a God who continues to dwell among us. Holy One, send your spirit. And as we continue in prayer, I want to invite prayers of gratitude and thanksgiving, these moments that raise us up, that help us to feel connected and centered. Give us a taste of that kingdom of God. What prayers of thanksgiving and celebration are there here today?
My neighbor's twin sons are graduated yesterday from the University of San Francisco, and they're having a big family to do down there, and those kids have lived next door to me every day of their lives.
For Joe and Dan on their graduation, I give thanks to God.
One for my big cousin Ethan. It's his birthday today, and I wanted to wish him just joy and happiness on this special day.
For Ethan on his birthday, I give thanks to God.
From Roger on Zoom, prayer of thanks for all the graduates, including Bobby, Sienna, and Kian, as they give us happy reminders of the passage of time.
For all of our graduates, for the happy reminders of passage of time, I give thanks to God.
Just a prayer of thanks. My daughter Jessica just got a new job. She's very happy. It's been several months of looking, and she wanted to find something that she could feel good about, and she has.
For Jessica and for change, I give thanks to God.
June and I were fortunate to join Roger and Abby yesterday in celebration of Sienna's graduation. That's a big moment, not only Sienna's life, but Roger and Abby. That's really a big accomplishment. Super the body is about that. So, you did her homework, that's for sure. Very nice to meet her family and everybody.
For celebration of Sienna's graduation and gathering as family and community, I give thanks to God. Other prayers?
Checking in with my middle daughter, the mom of three boys, seven and younger, so again, chaos pretty much all the time. But yesterday she happily reported that she had taken them all kayaking for the first time. And it was a great success, and I liked her line. They were all so happy and at peace. So for those moments that families struggle with to find happiness and peace, I give thanks.
Join our hearts.
I have a joy announcement. Woodland Park wrote some letters to encourage voters in important states to vote. And I don't know if I should share this fact because it's kind of depressing, but it takes 200 letters to actually encourage one person to vote. But you realize when you are writing a letter to someone that you don't know, for them to get a piece of mail, for someone to just convey how much, just a it out, and you never know what they're receiving. So, like, it's just this connection with someone that you don't know, in this prayer, and writing up with this group of people was so enjoyable. And we're not we're just gonna get together, and we do some writing, but a lot of talking and eating. And it's just like so many facets. Something that it has, you have no idea what's going to happen, but it's just such a strange, hopeful, magical, mysterious experience. So I'm not like trying to get y'all to.
For the strange magic that comes when communities gather together to encourage their fellow citizens to vote, and for the connection and hope that gathering contains, I pray. I give thanks to God. We're on something today. What's going on?
Okay, so I just want to say a prayer of gladness and excitement and joy for that experience of writing those letters. Because writing letters is not so great if you did it by yourself. It is so fun to do it with people here in this church and with the folks over at St. John's. I mean, it's so fun and funny. And the total experience for me is just pure joy. So I'm so thankful for that. And also that I don't have to write all those letters by myself. Yeah, no. And we're going to do it some more, so people have a chance to get in on this later.
Joy at the letter writing party and continued letter writing parties in the future. I give thanks to God.
For my niece in Texas, who I can't believe is old enough to graduate from high school, but she's graduating this year, and her name is Sarah, and for her sister, Dahlia, who's turning a teenager this week.
For Sarah and Dahlia, I give thanks to God.
A prayer of gladness for my mom, who fell about 6 weeks ago, had a pretty serious laceration, and then decided she wanted to move, and she's been driving her family crazy. And she came to the conclusion that she doesn't need to move. We're all very thankful for that. That's one. And number two is the birth of Andre David in California on Mother's Day. Not my grandson.
For the birth of Andre David, I give thanks to God. For Carolyn's mom and improvement, I give thanks to God. Truly a joyful Sunday.
maybe this is something that the rest of you already know, but I learned today that Betty's surgery went very well, and I'm extremely happy to hear that.
For successful surgery and recovery for Betty, I give thanks to God.
I'm going to add a prayer announcement. It's a good term that was just invented. Our sign team, we have a number of folks who are engaged in creatively designing and putting together the sign out front, changing it up, folks who are there to help brainstorm messages and make sure that we all like it. Really a great success this morning. If you haven't had a chance to stop outside and see the Pentecost sign, take a photo with it. I hope that you will. They worked very hard on that. For our sign team and the Pentecost sign, I give thanks to God.
From Roger, a prayer of joy that we have Mimi and Steve performing at Folklife this year.
For an opportunity to hear Mimi and Steve. And a second prayer announcement, is that a hand? A second prayer announcement, our sister church, our partner church, Primera Iglesia de Valle du Par, the church in Colombia that we've been communicating with for the last several years. Not all of you may be aware, but their official designation in their presbytery was not actually church, but congregation, which is a designation that reflects being smaller, being sort of in a place of having less stability. It's been a point of sorrow and frustration for our sisters and brothers in Valle du Par. And this next Sunday, May 26th, they will be having a worship service to celebrate being restored to status as a church. So being once again Primera Iglesia Presbyteriana de Valle du Par. And so we have an invitation to celebrate with them. So next Sunday, we've been having Zoom adult education with Jay Kyle, Deus Ex Musica, on the music and wisdom of the American folk revival, especially dwelling on Bob Dylan, but on other writers from that time. We will instead be spending, starting around 8:15, joining our sibling church in Valle du Par for that service. So if you are interested in participating and connecting and sharing in that moment of joy, it's going to be about 8:15 to about 9:45 our time. So that's what's going to be happening on the church Zoom channel. There'll be a place here in the sanctuary here in the church to watch that. Adult ed will continue to happen in the gathering space like usual. It just won't be on Zoom. So you'll have two opportunities to pre-church, I guess, but we'll be worshiping with our siblings in Valle du Par. And so for that change and for that opportunity to connect and worship with them, I give thanks to God. And if there are no other prayers of joy, let's continue in prayer. Using the words that Christ taught us, using the words that Christ gave us, it's printed in our bulletin today. Our Creator in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In a moment here, as our choir offers musical prayer, a plate will be coming by. And as you yourselves are in prayer, receiving this musical prayer, meditating on how God is moving in your life, meditating how the Spirit is animating you, a plate will come by.
And whether you're putting something into that plate or not, I want to invite you to reach out and touch that plate, maybe hold on to it for a beat. If you are joining us remotely on Zoom or Facebook, it's good to see your faces. You can reach out with your hand or use the raise hand button. I see Joy is already on that raise hand button. And that's because all of us, all of our contributions, all of the offerings of our time, our talent, our spirit, and yes, our treasure, come together to sustain what God is doing here in this place. And so as we have been blessed by God in many ways, we contribute to the ongoing work of God in this place in many ways. As we have been blessed, let us freely return for the portion for this work. Amen.
Thank you.
Spirit moves us in many ways. And with those gifts the Spirit gives us, we return offerings of care and hope for the work that God is doing here in this place. Holy One, receive our gifts, receive our prayers, and may thy work be done. Amen. Part of sharing of our time, our talents, our gifts, is that when things are happening in the church, when there are opportunities to connect in service and celebration, we share those with each other. So I see that many of you are already with the program. If you have an announcement to share with the church, I invite you to come share it.
In about 2 weeks, two Saturdays from now, June 1st, is the neighborhood's Rainbow Hop event, which is the neighborhood's pride event. Mindy and I are sort of spearheading the church's effort. It'll be similar to last year, where we're going to set up a tent on Greenwood Avenue there, and then have like a coloring activity. And last year, Harper and Polly made this beautiful rainbow backdrop that people could use as like a DIY photo booth thing, like to take fun pictures in front of. And we had a lot of fun helping get parents into those pictures with their kids. It's meant to be a kids pride event, so lots of people bring their kids around for it. So we had a lot of fun saying, oh, here, we'll take the picture for you, and then they could stand up and do that, and that was a lot of fun. So it's a great chance to get to, you know, talk with people in the neighborhood, which I assume Dave would support, and it's fun. It's like, I hope you'll at least consider stopping by, but we could also use folks, like, either planned in advance or not, to come, like, help us set up the tent, just hang out. The neighborhood association usually gives people like a little passport sheet thing that they can get stamps at the different places they stop. So we'll need someone to sit at a table and stamp people's passports. It's very chill. It's very fun. Please come.
I have multiple props. So, many of you maybe are not realizing this bin is sitting out there on the pew in the narthex. And it's empty so much of the time that I come in here. So, I'm going to re-emphasize what it's for. Gordon's Little Pantry donations. So, we're starting a new little mini program. June, we're asking you to bring tuna. So the tuna sign is going to be on the bin. So please, in the next week or two, grab some cans of tuna. Just like that. Peggy, thank you for donating 8 or 10 cans of tuna, and I donated 8 or 10 cans of tuna. So please, remember to do that. The pantry is suffering. We have not a lot of money. So, and it's totally gone. I mean, we put things in there and an hour later, it is empty. So whatever you can donate. And then just as a reminder, that's May. June is chilly. So think about it when you're in the store. I will put out this sign again so you'll be reminded all month long, cans of chili. And if you want to bring money and other things, please do. So don't forget this bin sits out there, and we'd like to see it with lots of stuff. Thank you.
Well, how do I follow that? So, wanted to remind the Property with Purpose team that we're going to be meeting right after the congregational meeting today. Hopefully it'll be a short meeting, but we want to get an update on how we're doing. And just to provide the rest of the congregation with a little status report on the Property with Purpose team, we are currently in our second phase, which is the exploratory phase. You may remember that the first phase was a listening tour in which we listened to all the members of the congregation about their ideas about needs in the community and ideas for our property. And that turned out to be great. And now we're out in the community having similar conversations. We've been meeting with other churches, with businesses, with neighbors, with nonprofit agencies, and it's been a great series of conversations. We've done over 20 of them, and we still have some more to go. And once we've done all that, we'll write that up and report back out to both the session and the congregation and see where our next steps are. So stay tuned. Thanks.
A couple things. Yes, thanks for the sign group. Elizabeth, Polly, I had them written down here. Elizabeth, Polly, April, Abby, thanks for all the work you did on that sign. That's beautiful. If you would like to join that group, get in touch with any one of those people and say, I want to join that group. We take suggestions for anything, any idea you've got. So spiritual formation met yesterday instead of Tuesday night. We had kind of a learning experience. Pastor Joe talked with us about the call to worship, the prayer of confession, and the assurance of grace. We learned about them, talked about them, and then we wrote some. It was pretty cool. I really enjoyed that. We're going to do that again in the future with other topics, perhaps, so keep an eye out for that. The Black Lives Matter witness today from 2 to 3:30 down by the high school, 15th and 65th. Bring a sign if you have one or just stop by. See, it's nice out. It's a great time to stand on the corner with Jean and I and Karen. It'll be awesome. Holy Hops is this Tuesday, 6:30 at Poor Decisions. Stop by for some amazing theological discussion and some good things to talk about and some good things to enjoy company and one of our favorite beverages and bring something to eat, a couple hours. It's a great time. Tuesday night, 6:30. That's all I got.
June, I'm in charge of helping recruit volunteers to make the service run. And I'm just gonna do some creative suggestions. If you're willing to do it, but you don't know what you want could do, just let me know. And also, if you think, oh, I could do something, but I'm just not sure that I'm going to be there that Sunday, just let me know that you're willing to be tapped. So if I see you that Sunday, I could say, hey, would you help out? And if you don't like to do something by yourself, we can match you up with someone and say, like, you want to be a greeter, but you're scared of people or something. You could go with someone that's very outgoing and kind of just shadow them and learn about the people that come in or just buddy up with people. So just either Jean or I, if you're willing to sign up, that would be, or not sign up, tell us that you're interested in being a part of helping on Sundays, that would be great.
Just a reminder that there's a congregational meeting right after church to elect our new officers.
I meant to mention this at Adult Ed this morning and forgot, so thank you, Roger, for the reminder that this weekend is the Folklife Festival. It's always an amazing time. I haven't been able to get there in a few years now, but it is a chance to see Steve and Mimi play, which we always love. But it's also a chance to sort of see one version of what folk music is these days. We talked in our first couple weeks of this session about all the different things that folk music can mean and has meant over the years. And as we're drawing to a close with this series, this is an excellent time to sort of get your ears and eyes out on what folk music is around here these days in our community. So I highly encourage you to go if you can. It is this Friday through Sunday, I believe. Yeah.
If there are no more announcements, let's continue in worship. Now, I don't see that we have some of our youngest community members around to help with this service,
So I'm going to invite those who are young at heart and have always wondered what it would be like to come stand here to join me at the table. And if nobody gets up, I'm going to request that all of our session members join me at the table. I want all of our session members to know that Jack has delivered them today. Thank you, June.
Yeah, don't do that. When we're actually, you know what? I would like my session members to come up here if they would. You all represent this church, you serve this church, you lead this church. On this Pentecost Sunday, when we celebrate that there are many gifts, that many of us called to serve and love and live, I'd love for our time at the table to reflect that. So, with Jack as our master of ceremonies and provider of microphones, scaring me, I'd like to ask one of our session members to tell us whose table this is. Hands? I want to see a hand because we got to get it on the microphone. Will you take that to June?
Everyone.
And so since this is everyone's table, who's welcome at this table?
Everyone.
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 At God's table, all are welcome. And so we say to one another, Todd, what do we say to one another?
God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to our loving God.
So at this table, we remember a meal that Christ had with his friends. Abby, I wonder if you can tell us what the first thing they did was.
They broke the bread.
They took bread and they blessed it, right?
Oh.
And then they broke it and offered them this bread. Will you hold this bread up for us? Saying, "This is my body broken for you." When you eat of this bread, when you share at this table, just like we are all sharing at this table in front of you, you proclaim my life, you proclaim my death, you proclaim that you are bonded in this journey of joy. In the same way, when the meal was over, he took a cup. Dave, I wonder if you would help us with the cup.
What would you like me to do?
You poured it out, and he offered it to them. Jack, would you offer this to David? And he said to them, "Drink, all of you. This cup is the promise of the new covenant. It's sealed in my blood. It's for you. It's for joy and transformation and liberation. When you drink of this, remember me." Gene, would you hold that up for us? Will you all pray with us? Will you hold that up? No, I want that up. There we go. Send, O God, your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts, that all who drink of them, all who eat of them, all who share in this table would be transformed, would be united with you and with Christians in every time and place, would be your light, life, and love in this world and for this world. In your name we pray and we bless you. Amen.
Friends, elders, thank you for your presence at this table, your patience with the soupiness, and for the love that has brought you here today. Come, the table is set, and all is right.
build a house where hands will reach beyond the wood and stone, to heal and strengthen, serve and teach and live the word they've known. Here to outcast and the stranger, bear the image of God's face. Let us bring an end to fear and danger. All are welcome.
Just as a house has many rooms, many parts, many pieces holding it together, making it up. And just as a body has many parts, many organs, many functions, so too are there many gifts, many people, many of us in this world. And you go claiming and naming and celebrating your gifts and the gifts of those around you in love and service. May the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all this day and every day. Amen. In a moment here, we're going to be passing out agendas. This is our congregational meeting.